the state capitol down here, we still have some sense of it, but it's 100% non-white. When I was growing up, I was talking earlier, you know, we had examples of Washington like Dale Buckers and David Pryor. And those examples in Arkansas now are just gone. And so we really, I want our kids to be able to look up to the leaders that we have in D.C. I want all of our kids to have leaders that have courage, heart, and decency. And so that's another reason that I'm here. But, you know, we have to make a difference in people's lives on the issues that matter to them on a daily basis. And again, you know, I look at my kids, those are the first people I look at when I talk about public policy. And early childhood education is the issue that's probably nearest and dearest to my heart. It's probably the issue that I made the most noise about in the legislature. But, you know, I thank God that we were able to read to our kids and put them in early childhood education at a few years of age. But every family in the United States deserves that opportunity. Right now, the federal government leaves 100% of that burden to the states. And our kids, every single kid in this country, every 2-, 3-, and 4-year-old kid deserves a right to fulfill 100% of their God-given potential. So let's be the generation that finally delivers access to high-quality early childhood education for every kid in this country. You know, my sister, who was here, she may have gone, but she just had a baby 7 weeks ago. And seeing that baby born, every family in this country deserves the opportunity to stay home with their newborn baby without being faced with a financial crisis in their family. When I first got to the legislature in Arkansas, one of the first bills I filed was a paid maternity leave program. And when that happened, folks down there looked at me like I was crazy, like I was speaking a different language. When my grandmother encountered someone who doesn't speak English, her philosophy was to speak slower and louder. And that happened to me a lot when that happened. But you know, that first session that I was in office, we passed it out of the House. It died by one vote, the Senate committee. But through that process, I got to know a whole lot of moms in Arkansas whose lives would have been changed by that legislation. And so we did a lot of work on it, put a lot of work into it before the next session. And after that session, it's now law in Arkansas. We're one of the only states in the country with a paid maternity leave program for state employees. And so I got that through on a bipartisan basis. I'm extremely proud of that. But that's the type of approach that I want to take to Congress. We're the only industrialized nation in the world without a paid leave program, which is a policy that's both as pro-family and as pro-business as you can get. In my opinion, the parents in our country deserve better. And so let's be the generation that finally delivers a paid family leave program to the families and the businesses in the United States. You know, there's a lot of working women here tonight, and it's stunning to me that in the United States in 2018, y'all have to work 30% longer to earn the same pay for the same job that a man does. That's not right. That's a failure of leadership. The women in our country deserve better, and let's finally be the generation that delivers equal pay for equal work for the women in the United States. But Congress has failed to act on these issues and a whole host of other issues, criminal justice reform, protecting our democracy, first from too much money in politics and now from a foreign threat where there's incontrovertible evidence that they're interfering in our elections. Protecting the environment, clean energy, infrastructure, which is a critical part of our economic development, especially in a rural place like Arkansas, and access to broadband education. Broadband wireless has to be a critical part of that because that's what's going to enable my brother-in-law works in the IT. I mean, this is what's going to enable people to start their businesses here instead of having to move to one of the coasts to follow their dreams. So that's a critical part of it. My sister-in-law's birthday yesterday, so I want to wish Randy a happy late birthday.
Happy birthday, Randy.
Thank you. But, you know, opioids, there's just a whole host of issues that Congress has failed to address. And then, you know, gun violence in the United States. When we were growing up, you know, we had tornado drills and fire drills. My kids are 85 years old. And they know what to do in an active shooter situation. And we've had that conversation with them, and the fact that they know what to do when a shooter is in their school is just completely heartbreaking to me. And you know, I grew up in Arkansas. My dad taught me how to shoot with a rifle on our family farm. So I have shotguns in my home. But there's a wide gulf between that and what the gun laws are in this country right now. And we need to do something to address gun violence because right now we have Americans, for the most part, American kids who are dying. Well, Congress needs to have the courage to stand up and do something about that. So, you know, those are some of the issues that I care about. As far as the race goes, you know, we got a shot in the arm a couple weeks ago. And for those of y'all who are political animals, there was a special election for a congressional race in Pennsylvania Connor Lamb was the Democratic candidate, and he won that race. It was a close race, but when he won, we started to get some attention out of it on a national basis, which is exciting. You know, no two districts are the same, and no two races are the same, but Trump won Connor Lamb's district by 20 points, and Trump won this district by 10 and a half points. So we have a much smaller margin to overcome. And the energy in the United States as a whole right now is just, it's amazing. In Illinois, they had their primary 6 days ago last week, and the number of voters in the Democratic primary in Illinois was up 200% over the last midterm election.
Wow.
So there's just a whole lot of energy. And so if anybody tells you that a Democrat can't win this race, that's not true. That's not true in the cycle. I would not have given up my seat in the state legislature, which I worked my tail off for and which I care a lot about. And I wouldn't have quit my job as a lawyer if I didn't fully believe that we can win this race. And I do believe that we're going to win. After Connor Lamb won, the New York Times in their write-up of his race, they gave me 3 full paragraphs. And then later in the week, U.S. News identified me as one of 5 candidates who could win a district in quote Trump country. And so we're starting to build some national momentum as well, which is exciting. But obviously, here is what matters most. In terms of what impact this election could have. First of all, just to stick with the national mood for a minute, I think we can change the country this year. You know, with elections like this, it's part of a collective effort, but we can't do it nationally unless we all do our part locally. And I think we ought to carry our weight here in Arkansas. This is the district that we can win in Arkansas to change the trajectory of our country and take our country back. And so that's why I'm running. That's another one of the reasons why I'm running. But on the basis for Arkansas, I think we can really transform the state just with this one election. We've gone from a one-party state to a one-party state in the last 10 years, but we can restore a sense of balance by winning this race and just turn the corner where people are what actually come first again. So I'm really excited about that. And everybody in this room can play a critical part in that. First of all, you know, as you all know, we're here to raise money tonight, and that's unfortunately an extremely critical part of the process. But the most important first hurdle for the campaign is how much money we can raise before the end of the quarter, which is March 31st. That's my first reporting deadline. And so that's what all the national folks are going to be looking at to see if we're a credible campaign or not. So thank you all so much for your contributions tonight. They matter. You know, we're buying some campaign signs right now. We have to get up on TV at some point. And, you know, a lot of people don't get their content on TV anymore. They get them on their phones and iPads and computers. And so we have to get on those mediums as well. And that doesn't replace the TV. It just adds to it. But we have to get our message out through all those mediums and people's mailboxes. We have staff and signs, and so every dollar that we raise makes a significant difference. So anything that you can do is awesome, and I greatly appreciate it. But in order for us to win this race, I not only need people that I know to support, I need y'all to get the people that y'all know that I don't know to support. And so, you know, if everybody here just got 3 friends to get $50 or $100 before Saturday, the end of the quarter, that reporting deadline, you know, that would be another $5,000 or $10,000 that we could raise this quarter. And that would be awesome. I mean, that would make a real difference in the race. So if y'all could go out and just get each get 3 friends to make a contribution online, that would be great. But of course, you know, money is not the only thing. We just need to help spread the word. My Facebook page is Clark Tucker for Congress. You can follow me on Twitter. It's just Clark Tucker. You just have to remember there's an E on the end of Clark. But, you know, we need votes. People are always more willing to vote for someone who vouches for them that they know. So just spreading the word with your friends, making posts on Facebook about our race. And then we're going to have plenty of volunteer opportunities. We're making phone calls and knocking on doors. When I was running for the legislature 4 years ago, I knocked on several thousand doors. And people are always like, oh, that must be terrible. Actually, I love it. It was my favorite part of the campaign. It's the purest form of politics. If you go to someone's door, I knocked on, I think, 3,000 doors, and I had 3 people who were outright rude. People are very welcoming, and you hear what's on their minds, and it's actually very refreshing. So we're going to be doing a lot of that. We're going to be doing a lot of phone calls. Anything that you can do, even if it's just an hour once, that adds up, and that'll make a difference. So I really appreciate everything. The last thing I'll say about my decision to run is when I was in the process of making that decision, my grandmother called me, the one who talks slower and louder to people who don't speak English. She said, I was trying to decide what to learn about it. And she said, Clark, you need to do this for your country. And And when I consider the fact that she was born in 1921, she grew up in the Great Depression, her husband was in World War II, she lived through Vietnam, the Watergate, civil rights movement, everything in between and since, and she said, Clark, now is when the country needs you and people like you to step up. That really made an impression on her. I mean, there's never an easy time to come home and say to your wife, I'm going to quit my job, and we're not going to spend very much time together for the next 10 months. And to tell your kids, you know, who I love with every fiber of my being, and I want to be with them all day, every day, that I'm not going to get to spend as much time with them as I would like. And they may hear something about their dad on TV or on the late night sometime, or tell all your friends that you need their money and their time so you can get elected to Congress, right? But it gets a lot easier when you understand that, you know, this, my name's on the sign, but this race is not about me. It's about all of us. It's about everyone in Little Rock and all of Central Arkansas. It's about our kids and their future. It's about our parents and their dignity. It's about restoring courage, heart, and decency to the political process, standing up to give a voice for people who need something done for them. It's about understanding that cancer doesn't have a political party, that hunger, hopes, and dreams, despair don't have political parties. It's about a love for our country, who we want to be as a people, and about America, the beacon of hope and light in the world that we have been and that we always ought to be. So that's why I'm running. I'm so happy that y'all are part of it. I'm so grateful to you for being here tonight. And thank you so much.
Heartwarming and energizing for me. So I just want to take a few minutes and talk about why I'm running and a few of the issues that I really care about, and then just talk about the race for a little bit. So first of all, just why I'm running. When I first started thinking about running for Congress was last summer when the House passed the American Health Care Act, and which was the repeal without the replacement, essentially. And after they passed that bill, they celebrated about it in the Rose Garden. And just my time in the legislature, first of all, really drove home to me how important access to health care is, both at on a big level and on a personal level. On the big level, Arkansas, you know, was one of only two states in the South to expand Medicaid. And we have 300,000 people in Arkansas who depend on that program for access to care. It was a bipartisan program, and that's 10% of our state's population, and that bill would have completely dismantled that bipartisan program. And that's just that's a failure of leadership of the United States Congress. On a personal level, you know, in the Arkansas legislature, we don't have personal staff. So when our constituents have issues, they just call us. So I had a constituent who called me, and his daughter and his granddaughter were 100% eligible for Medicaid, but they had been on the waiting list for 6 months. And his granddaughter was about 8 years old, and she couldn't go to school until she got her medication. And they had just been waiting for 6 months, and I was able to make a call to DHS and get enrolled in Medicaid within 24 hours. And they called me the next day, and it just shows you, you could just hear in his voice, their lives were just transformed, because that's what access to care meant to their family. And a week later, I got another call like that, and I think I started to develop a little bit of a reputation, because I started getting calls from all over the state from people who were eligible for Medicaid but just had a hard time getting in because they didn't know how to work the system properly. But all of their stories were different, but they were equally compelling about how in this life, health care comes first. Because without that, you can't work, you can't take care of your family, and if you're a kid, then you can't learn, you can't go to school, you can't develop. Then later in the summer, the health care issue became a lot more personal for me when I was diagnosed with bladder cancer. Fortunately, I was having some symptoms. I'm 100% cancer-free today, and that's the most important thing. But last summer, I was quite fortunately having some symptoms, and so we went in for a test, and they had to put me under for just a few minutes, and when I woke up, I was in the room by myself with my wife, and you know, she was crying. And I asked her what was wrong, and she said, you have a tumor. And the notion of having access to care with a pre-existing condition without dying or going bankrupt became a lot less abstract in that moment. And 32% of people in Arkansas have pre-existing conditions, and that bill would have completely removed protections for access to care for all of those people. And as I mentioned, They celebrated after they passed it in the Rose Garden, and if they could pass that bill again tomorrow, they would. And that's a moral failure of leadership by the United States Congress, and that's why I'm here.
Here.
Another reason why I'm running is because I want our kids to grow up in the same kind of country that we all grew up in. And we can't take that for granted. We live in the greatest social and political experiment in the history of the world. We're not perfect. We have a lot of work to do. But we've made progress over the last 250 years, and that's not a coincidence. You know, does anybody here just completely take their marriage for granted and also have a great marriage? You know, that's just not how it works. And so we can't take the country for granted either. The reason we've been able to make progress is because every generation has taken up the torch when it was their turn, and they moved the ball forward. They moved the ball down the field. And if there were ever a time for my generation to step up to the plate and take our country back, move our country in a different direction, go in a different trajectory, that time is now. And we need candidates with courage, heart, and decency. Because it does take courage to run, because people take shots at you. People have already started taking shots at me, and it's going to get a lot worse between now and November. But once you're in office, it takes courage to have loyalty to the people that you represent and that put you into office, instead of to the entrenched money special interests that are trying to influence your vote. It takes heart, because you have to really love your country. You have to have passion for the people that you're trying to help. And it takes decency. And that's just missing from Washington right now. We've lost all civility.
Yes.
When I was growing up, our examples in Washington were Dale Bumpers and David Pryor. That's not exactly the examples that our kids have in Washington today. And I want our kids and all of our kids, that work that every generation before us has done, it didn't stop with them, it won't stop with us, it's going to continue with our kids. But I want those kids to look to their leaders in Washington and see people with courage, heart, and decency, and that's also my thing. So, some of the issues that I care about, pre-K education is probably the one that I chirp the most about, and the state legislature made the most noise about, because a lot of the issues for me just go back to my kids. I look at them and I see the spark in their eye, and I thank God that we were able to read to them from the day they were born and put them in school at just a few years old. And every kid in this country deserves that same opportunity. We should never look a 2 or a 3 or a 4 year old kid in the eye and tell them that they're not going to have every opportunity to fulfill 100% of their God-given potential. And in the legislature, I was able to work, and we were able to get the first permanent increase in pre-K funding in over 10 years. It wasn't enough, but it was a permanent increase in funding. Right now, the federal government puts 100% of that burden on the states. That's not right. Every kid in this country deserves better. Let's be the generation that finally delivers access to high-quality early childhood education, and that's why I'm running. My sister's here with her newborn baby, whose name is Catherine Clark, by the way. And so her baby is 7 weeks old. And when I look at her, and we went through the same thing as a family, and I see that no family in this country should have to make the impossible decision between having a financial crisis in their family and being able to stay at home with your newborn baby. We're the only industrialized nation in the world without a paid family leave program. When I was first elected to the legislature 4 years ago, one of the first bills that I filed was a paid maternity leave for state employees program. And when that happened, people looked at me, and my grandmother's here tonight, Catherine Bost. My granddad told me that when they took a trip to China one time, and when they would learn that someone wouldn't speak English, that my grandmother would talk louder and slower to them. But when I filed that paid maternity leave bill of legislation, that's the same way people try to talk to me now. They didn't know what it was or what it meant. And we were able to pass it off the House floor, actually the first time I filed it in 2015. And it died by one vote in a Senate committee. But the relationships I was able to build with new mothers just showed me the kind of impact it can have on a family's life. And then the next time we had a session in 2017, that bill is now law, and we're one of the only states in the country with that paid maternity leave program. And so it's the most pro-family and pro-business policy that you can have. And so let's finally be the generation that delivers a paid family leave policy for the families and businesses of this country. And that's another reason why I'm running. Of course, you know, there's a lot of women in the room tonight. My wife owned a small business for 7 years. And when she went out to buy the supplies for her business, it cost her the same amount that it cost me. And when women in the United States work today, they have to work 30% longer than men do to earn the same pay for the same work. That is wrong. So let's finally be the generation that delivers, finally, equal pay for equal work. Congress has failed to address all of these issues. They failed on criminal justice reform, which Jim Conner and I have worked on together, on protecting our democracy, first from too much money and now from a foreign threat. And there's incontrovertible evidence that they're interfering with our democracy, with the environment, with clean energy, with infrastructure, which is critical to our economy, especially with broadband access, with the opioid crisis. And of course, as we know, it's really central to the conversation right now is with gun violence in the United States. You know, when I was growing up, when all of us were growing up, we had fire drills and tornado drills. And when I talk to my 8 and 5 year old kids about the drills they have in school today, they know what to do when there's an active shooter in their school. And that just breaks my heart. And it is a mental health issue, but it's not just a mental health issue. It's a failure of Congress to have the courage to pass some common sense gun safety laws. So the good news is there is something we can do about it. We can run for this office and get elected. And the good news is that we're going to win. We're going to win this race. Job and giving him my seat in the state legislature before I ran if I didn't believe we were going to win. But it's good to get some external validators. So 2 weeks ago, we got a real shot in the arm when Connor Lamb won his election.
Yeah.
And just to put in, no two districts are the same, but just to give you some context, Trump won that district by 20 points and he won this district by 10 and a half points.
All right.
Smaller margin to overcome. And when that happened, we started getting some real national press. The New York Times included our campaign in the write-up of Connor Lamb's victory. The U.S. News identified us as one of 5 candidates that can win a district in Trump.
Yeah.
So when we win, the impact that we're going to have on the country is going to be huge. This one race is going to be part of a collective effort across the country to take the country back. But this one race by itself is going to transform the state of Arkansas.
Yeah.
It's going to be a turning point for us where people actually come first again for the first time in a while. And I'm really excited by that. Arkansas runs deep in my veins. I know it does for everybody here. And I care very deeply about that. So, you know, how can y'all help? Obviously, we're here to raise money tonight, and Kathy's making a strong pitch, which is great. I want you to know why it matters. First of all, campaigns are expensive, and y'all know that. We have to get up on TV, and that's going to be very expensive. Most people get their content from different places now. It doesn't replace our ability to get up on TV. We have to get on phones and computers in addition to having to get up on TV. We got to be in people's mailboxes. We have some great staff coming on. We got to pay them. We can't have all volunteers, but there's a lot of money involved, and we're going to have a very well-financed opponent. The only way we can win is to be financially competitive. Right now, it's extra important because our first fundraising reporting deadline is this upcoming Saturday, and that's what all the national folks are going to be looking at to see whether our campaign is credible and viable. So if you're going to give an extra $25 down the line, I would ask you to please go ahead and give it tonight so we can include it in our first report. But, you know, there's so much energy here tonight. I just want to just get everybody on board and let's just march forward. We have so much momentum. We got a volunteer open house next Thursday, so please come by that. It'll be on our Facebook page. But just spreading the word. If only the people that I know support me, then it's not going to be enough this time around. What I need y'all to do is, you know, within the next week, talk to 5 people about pitching in for the race, whether it's knocking on doors, putting up a sign, making a contribution, voting for me, or whatever the case might be, because that's what it's going to take to win. The last thing I'll say, I've been going too long, but about my decision-making process is when I was trying to decide whether to run, my grandmother called, and she said, Clark, you need to do this for your country.
Yeah.
Great Depression,
yeah.
World War II, Vietnam War, civil rights, Watergate, everything in between and since. And she says to me, Clark, your country needs you now, and we need people like you to step up. You know, that weighs heavy on my mind. And don't get me wrong, there's never an easy day to come home and tell your wife that you're going to quit your job. You're not going to be able to spend as much time with her over the course of the next year as you would like. But also, you know, tell your kids, who you love with every fiber of your being, that you're not going to be able to spend as much time with them as you like. And they may hear some about their dad on TV or on the playground that they're not going to like. And to tell all your friends that you need their money and their time so you can get elected to Congress. But it's a lot easier when you recognize that this race is not about me. It's about everyone in this room. It's about everyone in this county, in this region, and in this state. It's about our kids and their future. It's about our seniors and their dignity. It's about restoring courage, heart, and decency to the political process. It's about standing up and giving a voice to people who need something done in their government. It's about understanding that cancer does not have a political party. Hunger does not have a political party.
Amen.
Hopes and dreams don't have political parties. It's about a love of this country and what kind of people we want to be. It's about making America the beacon of hope and light in the world that we have been and that we always should be. So that's it. That's all I got. But that's why I'm running. And thank y'all so much.